I think first of all, we've just been talking to Tien, and I just wonder how happy you are for him, apart from anything at the weekend, to get a win, first game in front of the home crowd, and to be able to walk off with 3 points, because he clearly loved it.
Yeah, really happy. And he had a key involvement in the third goal. He showed a really good understanding of the time to pass the ball. And then of course you have to get like the speed of the pass right, the angle of the pass right. It's a scary moment that. And he said to me immediately after the game, like, that is really scary being that high up the pitch with the ball at your feet. But you know, if the opposition try to deny every single pass that you can play, which they, you know, Dorking done that so they're so brave, they really are. Like, they try to build up with the ball in the first half relentlessly, and I thought we pressed them really hard because honestly we were really concerned that if we let them take the ball, they've got the second highest possession in the league. If we let them take the ball, they could be running riot at Meadow Lane with a ball, and that would not be a nice feeling. So we were really concerned. I felt like the front of the pitch, they really pressed really hard, and then they changed because in the second half they wanted to stop us at all cost having the ball, and then the only spare player was Tiernan, and he came up the pitch to get close to all the outfield players so that he can hit the pass wherever, you know, he decided to hit the ball, and they hit plenty of balls, you know, to the top of the pitch. We saw that high pressure action for Dorking to defend, kind of 20 yards out from their goal, like four against four. But then if they got the press a little bit wrong, the pressure was on Tiernan to play. And he made an action just before the goal. Adam Chickson is the spare man when he jumps from Chicks to Badge, and then Badge plays round the corner. Chicks travels up the pitch, try to put Jody Jones in on the outside, and we end up with a corner. And then we repeat the same action. And Dorking knew what was going on, but they just were so brave that, like, no, we'll steal this one. You know, we'll go again and we'll steal it off the goalkeeper, young guy. You know, the Dorking manager was calling on to his players. The keeper's getting sloppy. He's getting tired. Go and press him. He'll make a mistake. And you know, it was really like cards on the table. This is what we're doing. And it was a high pressure moment from Tiernan, and he made a key pass. He's there. And we scored a goal. So he was involved in a lot of stuff, you know. And the goal we can't really do much about. Speed and precision again, those two things when they're combined together, and the guy sneaks the ball past him at the near. So he was great. He was really great, and I'm really happy for him.
Personal note, how satisfying is it for you to be able to hand, you know, a debut and then a home debut to a young lad like that and help his progression?
Yeah, I think a number of things. First of all, huge thanks to Sam Slocum, because he has been the guy that's had to try and learn all the detail from me, and he's made such a brilliant example of that Tiernan can follow plenty of good work from Sam. Then Sam, because of his nature, he's really helping Tiernan a lot. You know, really a lot, and he's helping him to understand different things and talking him through it. And also, we have to say, you know, Archie has been brilliant, and you know, what a fantastic response from him, because he's so disappointed, but he's really helped Tiernan prepare. And full credit to the entire goalkeeping union and Tom Will. Brilliant, absolutely brilliant. So there's a lot gone into the performances for Tiernan, and he's taken his opportunity.
Eastleigh up next, although I've kind of seen them progressing, but I hadn't quite realised the extent as to how well they've done of late. Seven wins in their last nine, they've drawn one other. I think they've only conceded a couple of goals in that time as well. They're on an extraordinary run, aren't they?
Yeah, and when we played them the first time around, they had the same record, I think, at home that we had, and they're an excellent team. And they have a lot of threats. They can, you know, they can really put teams on the back foot. And the game at their place, I felt really uncomfortable. I felt really uncomfortable, and I think like the last probably 20 minutes feels very different, but that was the end of a battle of two teams really, you know, going up against each other, and they've improved from then. So we're geared up, we're ready. We know it's going to be a really tough game. We don't expect to have everything our own way. We don't. But you know, you have to keep playing against really good teams. You have to keep playing against teams that are motivated and well organised. And well, we have to you know, prepare as thoroughly as we can and make a good performance. Otherwise, we'll get nothing.
You do get these teams, don't you, sort of make a surge late on in the season. Do you think whoever, assuming they can stay up there and into a playoff place, then they're a genuine threat in those playoffs to whoever ends up playing them, and possibly even promotion candidates this year?
Oh yeah, they're a threat, no doubt about it. You can't accidentally have this type of record that they have. You know, you can't stumble into that. That's about preparation, and it's about quality on the pitch, all the things combined. You just can't do it otherwise, and they're a huge threat. But you know, we you know, you look at Barnet when they came here, incredible form, such a good team, and the first half they go in 1-0 up deservedly. They came here, they ran all over us at times in the first 45 minutes, and we managed to make a really good, impressive second 45. And Southend, what a brilliant team they are. They barely conceded a goal. I felt suffocated throughout the whole game. And again, we come away with a good result, and the guys made like a monumental performance to put the game, you know, 4-0. It sounds crazy because I never felt like 4-0. Felt suffocated because they have so many tools and such a good team. So we have to face these teams one after another that are in good form, that are chasing down playoff places, and we have to do that again. We have to go again.
That's great. Thank you very much. I'll leave you with Ollie for the last.
Hi, Luke. I'll start with the weekend. So Adam Chipson made his 100th appearance for the club. You've only been here for a small portion of that time, but how important has he been for the team this season? Is he the model pro for the youngsters in the academy coming through?
Yeah, he is. He's been so important, because the performance on the pitch, you know, look at the goals that he scored, match-winning goals at times, you know. But then look at the way that he runs back to protect the goal, like his life depends on it. The way that he defends the far post when it's sustained spell of pressure, you know, he has to defend the far post, incredible. Then the bits that we're not, you know, people are not privy to see. The way he concentrates in a meeting, the way he delivers meetings. He delivers meetings better than I do. It's embarrassing. But he is the example, with the shining light, how to behave, how to apply yourself day in, day out over a long period of time. Amazing. He's the kind of package of how we want people to respect the job of being a player for Notts County. And many players, you know, many players are in that mould. But Chicks is like a very good example of that, really top example.
And then it was announced earlier today that Joel Taylor had left the club. Can you explain what the situation was and how that decision came about?
Yeah, you know, look, Joel, we know, has real talent. You know, he's got a cannon of a left foot that he can put the ball wherever he wants, but there was times when I just felt like in transition mainly, and it's important for me to say he had a tough time with me, because I demand a lot from him, from all the players. And you know, I think the guy that you just spoke about really makes it difficult, because he's so intense, he's so deliberate with everything he does. He's there every minute of every single day. And when you're up against that type of competition, it's like, It's challenging, because you have to match that bare minimum before your quality can shine through. And you know, he went on loan to get more game time and started well there, and then had a bit of a tough time and didn't play as many minutes as he wanted to play. And then when he returns back to County, then we're in a great place and many players playing really well. So such tough competition, and he expressed the desire to go and try and kickstart his career again. And when a guy's been really good and behaving, and really, like I've said many times, because I want to set the tone that if you come in and you apply yourself every day and you're a good pro, if even if you're having a bad time, that's what's expected of you. And if you do that, then I'll try to help. And I think that, you know, yes, we left ourselves a little bit short on numbers, but it was the right thing to do at the right moment. We want everybody really focused for this run-in. And I think it was becoming increasingly more difficult for Joel to do that.
I was about to say, yeah, with that, you're now down another defender. Has that perhaps changed your approach for the final nine games and wanting to strengthen, particularly in defence?
Well, I think, you know, the position that Joel played in the left wing-back position, I think that Jody has now shown that he can understand the defensive duties that are required to play in that role. And he has great quality. So, yeah, I think we have balance now back on the left side, and we still have the chance to bring people in. Richard Brindley is close to coming back to the group, so we are going to gain another defender. We're quite confident that we have enough bodies in all the different departments and the quality that's required to keep us ticking over.
And then you were missing Carl Cameron at the weekend through illness. How's he feeling? Is tomorrow perhaps a bit too soon, or can you expect him to be available?
Well, he's available because he trained today. How much he's suffering, you'll never know, because he's a warrior. So for him to not be able to make the game, I know it must be like bad, really, really bad. He must have felt terrible, because there's no way, you know, he's not going to be away from the team for anything less than seriously feeling terrible. But he came in today, as we'd expected, and he trained with the group. So now I have a decision to make whether he can start or not.
And then just another update on returning players. Sam Slocum obviously missing for the past couple of games. What's the update on him?
Yeah, he's getting closer to being able to train with the group. He's making good, steady progress. So we don't think that would be too... I don't want to put a time scale just yet, because he needs to come for one or two more tests before we know where he is, but he's doing well. He's doing well.
And then just finally, so one result away from Meadow Lane did affect you, and that was Altrincham's progression to the semi-finals of the FA Trophy, which means your fixture away to them has to be moved. Have you had any indication on when that fixture change may be arranged for, and how does that, again, affect preparations?
Yeah, it's a shame, because now we don't know. We're waiting to find out when the game will go in. And that's a bit frustrating, because it's hard to plan too much ahead. But these things happen, and it's nobody's fault. We just now need to have communication with the league, and I think that will be resolved very soon, and that will be official. That will be announced sometime very soon, I'm sure.